What's up, everyone? So there are some conflicting reports with this. I saw some stuff on Twitter, actually, before I started recording this. I didn't put it in because the latter source, which is the Tor Project, to me was more believable. So anyways, imagine logging into your server one day to find that it's flagged, basically, for activities that you know you never actually initiated. And entire network suddenly under siege, and you have absolutely no idea why. That is exactly what happened to many Tor node operators within the Tor network during a coordinated attack at the end of October. Before we jump into that, though, and what really happened, let's first break down some of the two key players that are in the Tor ecosystem that were actually targeted, which is directory authorities and relay operators. Directory authorities are air traffic controllers, if you will, of the actual Tor network. These special servers act as centralized coordinators, if you will. They keep everything organized and ensure smooth operation. They maintain a list of all the available relays, making sure that users can connect to the one that promotes network efficiency and security the most. Basically, imagine them as managers overseeing a complex operation. They need to know what relays are active and trustworthy at any given moment to keep the network functional and safe in general. Relay operators, on the other hand, are the actual lifeblood of Tor. They're the individuals or organizations, in some cases, who volunteer their server power and bandwidth to run Tor relays, in some cases the feds, which are essential, basically. Not the feds, but the relay operators are essential. That's who I was actually referring to. to keep user activities anonymous. Think of them as messengers in a large type of, you know, protest, passing information from one person to another, ensuring that no one can track where the original note or message actually came from. That's kind of their point, right? Relay operators make Tor more resilient, distributing the data so that, you know, no single point can be easily compromised. So now if we're getting into the actual attack, right? It's kind of like a mix between IP spoofing and a DDoS attack. But concentrating on the IP spoofing attack, try to picture this. And attacker, right, sending data packets across the internet, but faking their origin in order to make it look like they're actually coming from somewhere else. It's like someone calling you, but disguising their phone number with one of those spoof cards in order to show up as your friend. In this instance, the attacker basically forged internet packets to make them seem like they're originally from the Tor relays, creating a false narrative that Tor itself was conducting unauthorized scans. Now, this illusion led to abuse complaints aimed directly at the Tor relays, creating chaos among its operators. The attacker aimed to sow distrust, right, and trigger disruptions, and potentially to try and get Tor IP addresses actually blocked by hosting providers. So in October, the Tor network faced a pretty severe disruption as its directory authorities, relay operators, and even some of the Tor Project sysadmin team members began receiving a crazy avalanche of abuse complaints. Now, these complaints were tied to the claims of authorized port scanning activities, which caused confusion and stress among the community. But upon investigation by the Tor Project, it became clear that these reports basically resulted from a coordinated IP spoofing attack to undermine the Tor Project and its network specifically. Complaints were sent to directory authority operators like Roger Dingleline, Sebastian, and Linus, and also affected non-exit relays and directory authorities at hosting providers. The nature of the traffic involved was basically unsolicited SYN-ACK, and RST packets targeting port 22 from distributed IP addresses. To clarify, in a typical TCP connection, the process starts with a SYN or synchronization packet, which is like one computer saying to another, you know, hi, I want to have a conversation. The receiving computer responds with the SYN-ACK or synchronized acknowledgement packet, meaning, hello, I hear you, and I'm ready to talk. And finally, the original computer sends an ACK or an acknowledgement packet to confirm the connection, which fully establishes the connection at that point. Now, meanwhile, an RST or REST packet is used to basically abruptly close the existing or unwanted connection, like hanging up a phone call, basically. The attacker's spoofed packet made it look like Tor relays were actually attempting to connect in an unauthorized way or have unauthorized communications, which led to actions like the server shutdowns and, you know, account suspensions for some relay operators. Some of the relay operators, in response to this kind of stuff, tried to do preventative measures like reinstalling their operating system, reconfiguring Tor, and setting up things like monitoring on directory authorities. They also use tools like Tcpdump to capture and analyze network traffic, confirming the presence of these unsolicited packets. Now, a ton of relays actually had to respond to complaints from their hosting providers, and this created unnecessary stress for all those people that were actually involved. This incident didn't affect end users, so the Tor project claimed, and the Tor network continued to function and provide anonymous, censorship-resistant internet access. The Tor community throughout all this demonstrated exceptional resilience, especially to the collaboration between the Tor community, InterSec Lab, and support from Andrew Morris and the team at Gray Noise. The coordinated effort to identify the source of the spoofed packets was successful. The attacker's origin was eventually identified and shut down on November 7th. I couldn't find any more information aside from that. If you know of anything, I'd love to hear it. Definitely reach out to me. Pierre Bourdon, a relay operator, was an important figure in the response who provided a detailed attack analysis. His post, which was labeled "One Weird Trick to Get the Whole Planet to Send Abusive Complaints to Your Best Friends," explained how spoofed IP address packets were used to create a flood of automated abuse complaints to begin with. His insights were very important to actually understanding the attack's nature, and the community widely appreciated his contributions. Throughout this incident, operators engaged directly with the abuse reports to clarify the situation and mitigate the impact of some false reports. Gus, a member of the Tor community, provided a response template to help relay operators communicate effectively with their hosting providers, basically explaining that their relays were targeted by a spoofing attack rather than originating the actual suspicious activity themselves, while support basically poured in from a bunch of different individuals and organizations. There were also instances of things like setbacks where some hosting providers basically disagreed or just outright refused to actually investigate the legitimacy of the complaints, inadvertently amplifying the actual attack's impact overall. And the Tor project has called on hosting providers to exercise more diligence in these type of situations in the future to try to prevent unnecessary disruption of the essential services. So what's the next step if you're a operator of a relay, for example? Well, the Tor project has basically stated that for relay operators still facing these kind of issues, such as blocked or suspicious relays, the Tor project has recommended a few steps to try to help resolve the problem. First, operators should use OONI Probe's circumvention test to verify their reachability of Tor directory authorities. Now, this is important because it helps determine whether the hosting providers blocks prevent the relay from reconnecting to the network. Second, operators are definitely encouraged to contact their hosting companies using the incident details to try and clarify that their relays were actually victims of the IP spoofing attack and were not actually originators of any suspicious activity. This can absolutely help convince hosting providers to unblock relays, as it shows the problem was not actually caused by malicious behavior on the operator's part. So sharing the official blog post about the incident can also help when trying to convince your hosting provider that you aren't doing anything bad, basically. It helps them understand what actually happened and speed up the restoring services process. Now, despite the disruption, this incident has actually shown the strength and determination of the Tor community, which was meant to actually cause discord and strife, actually backfired on the attacker. Over the days following the attack, relay operators shared information and supported one another via email and chat, and kind of worked tirelessly to keep relays online and stable. The Tor network absolutely remains a vital tool for those seeking privacy, anonymity, and a way to circumvent internet censorship, as well as a way to avoid, you know, constant surveillance of government monitoring and advertisers. The importance of Tor can't be overstated, especially in regions where things like digital surveillance is rampant and access to information is restricted. The attack was a reminder of, you know, the vulnerabilities that our online services face on a daily basis, but it also showed the resilience of the decentralized Tor community, which is very interesting to actually see in real time as this was going down. Sometimes, you know, living a good long life is the best way to give your adversary the finger. The Tor project basically thanked all the relay operators for their continued efforts. The attack was definitely a challenge, according to the Tor project, but it also brought out the very best in the community, right? What that was a commitment to defending the actual network and protecting online privacy and anonymity. The collective effort basically ensured that the Tor network remained a free expression and access source, even under this kind of pressure. The fight for privacy and freedom on the internet continues unabated, to the dismay of whoever the scumbag was who was actually trying to weaponize and tarnish the network. So I'd love to hear what you think about this. Thank you for watching to the end, and as always, I'll see you in the next video.